everybody, to the Martini Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center in CUNY. My name is Frank Henschken. I'm the Executive Director and Director of Programs at the Segal Center. Our center bridges academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And of course, also we have a publication site, which is a small little boat, you know, which we also try to run. We are actually the largest publisher of plays, texts from the Arab world, but we have many books on plays with playwrights who we have worked with over the time, whether it's Romania, Czech Republic, Spain, Belgium, and many others. And our distributor is a fantastic, a great institution that has supported for over decades and decades the American Theaters, the Theater Communication Group, which you all know from their great publishing line, from the service to the field, from the TCG conferences, and also from the American Theater Magazine. So tonight is an evening dedicated to what we call publishing for the theater. We have that as an ongoing event, field journals, international ones. Next year, actually, the Berlin Theater will come, the theater, yeah. And so maybe that's also a way to for you guys to come back. So tonight we will have a real rare evening where we have with us Terry Nemeth, who's the head of TCG Publishing. He does not come so often to these books and events, yet you will see him often at conferences. He's a big promoter of theater artists, of theater writers, of writing for the theater. You will see him at book stands, and he's the one who you know, holds the strings and makes many things possible. We have with us Kameron Steele as an example of some of the work that is being done on the publishing, and it's the new book on Tadashi Suzuki. Kameron worked on, we know Kameron from his work with Robert Wilson, his work with his own theater company, and also his Japanese connection. He has been quite a force in that field, and we have done many events here. And also with us, we have, as an introduction, the new editor of American Theater since when?
July.
Since July, and it's Bob or Robert Weinert-Kendt. So we say Bob tonight, since it is the Segal Center. And welcome also back to the Segal Theater. You once were here in the evening when it was about blogging. And was it for the Prelude Festival, or?
I think it was.
Yeah, I think that's so, yeah. when you came here earlier. So you see, you always see a little bit ahead of the curve, you know, that these significant contributors to the field. The evening will not last longer than 90 minutes, and we will first have an introduction about TCG and the work for the publishing TCG does. It is quite remarkable, I think, not really known as how vast that field really is, how big the contribution is, one of the reasons to do this, and it's really a great service to the field. Then Kameron will talk a bit about his work, about the book project, and then for this evening, Tadashi Suzuki created a video and a conversation with Kameron just for you all up here. We tried to do a Skype, but through the time difference and other things, it was not possible. Maybe one day he will make it here, and hopefully that will be. It's not impossible, not unthinkable that he does my last US trip, but then he will be part of it. We will talk a bit about the book, and then Rob will talk a little bit about his ideas, his vision for the magazine. And then we have a little reception here. So if you have a cell phone, this is now the important part, just take it out for a moment. I'll do the same, and let's make sure it's on silent. Okay. Mine now is. Again, thank you all for coming, and also I see many friends and great workers in the Vineyard of Theater here with us. So thank you all for coming. And is this mic on? Can you hear me? It's not really on, I think.
Hope you can hear it. Yeah.
Yes, I tried very hard, but 1, 2, 1, 2. Is it on? 1, 2, 1, 2.
No.
No. Oh, we try again. 1, 2. Let me check another mic. I don't think it's the mic, but 1, 2, 1, 2. No. So we also recording the. Oh, that sounds much better. And. And maybe if there are good reasons that the gods of theater said we don't really need that introduction as part of the video. So again, thank you all for coming. As I always say, and I think it is really true, we need great, great theater, but we also need a good audience, an informed audience, an audience that has a sense about history and history about theater. So really, thank you for coming. And that's a beautiful evening of the last warm day. So Kameron.
Sure.
No, a tariff. Thank you so much. So this time, let's see the talk.
Thanks, Frank and Mark D. Segal Center for inviting us tonight. I'll give you a little background about what TCG is for those of you who don't know. For over 50 years, Theater Communications Group, or TCG, has existed to strengthen, nurture, and promote the professional not-for-profit theater in the United States. We were founded in 1961 by the Ford Foundation to provide a connection point or as a communication tool for what they envisioned was this expansion of the not-for-profit resident or regional theater in the United States. At that time, there were only a few handfuls of theaters across the country that were active outside of what was going on in Broadway. Today, TCG has a membership of over 500 theaters in 47 states, 110 university affiliates, CUNY is one of those, and nearly 10,000 individual members. We offer a variety of programs, including grant-making and professional development, distributing more than $2 million in grants each year to help build a new generation of practitioners for the field. Major new program initiatives include one on equity, diversity, and inclusion, which is set up to work with staffs and structure within our member theaters. Additionally, we have a program called SPARK, which is to develop young leaders of color for future leadership positions. We provide research tools and management for management leaders, including a fiscal survey for the field, salary surveys, governance, and education outreach. We are the primary issues advocate for issues on the federal level, and TCG is a founding member of the Performing Arts Alliance, the Coalition of Performing Arts Advocates. Another important initiative that TCG is involved in now is Blue Star Theater, and that's working with the Blue Star Family Foundation to have our theater, member theaters, work with military families in their community. It's a new program we've been doing for the last 3 years. TCG is also the U.S. Center for the International Theater Institute. Obviously, we're here tonight to talk about publishing, which is one of our more visible programs. It includes our magazine, both online and in print, which has been published since 1983. Rob will be discussing that later in the program. We also publish Art Search, which is an online resource for jobs and careers in the arts. We've been doing that since 1980. It was a printed piece at one time. Now it's an online job bulletin, and there are something like 8,000 jobs that are listed each year in Art Search. Other resources to explore would be our website, tcg.org, and our blog, the TCG Circle. The TCG publication started in the 70s with a series of reference books which were really of the field and for the field. They were books, they were a directory of theaters, there was a biannual listing of all the productions that were done in our theaters across the country. Those things now are both online resources and available there. We began in the 80s with an expansion of the program. At that point, most of the large publishers in the United States had stopped publishing plays and drama titles because it just was not economically, in their minds, viable. Read, they weren't making any money on it. There were a few publishers like Grove Press who were still publishing plays, but they were publishing mostly European or British authors like Beckett, Brecht, Pinter, Ionesco, or Artaud. When we looked around the field, some of our greatest artists, like Stephen Sondheim, none of his work was in print. The great South African playwright, Athol Fugard, had one book in print from his entire work as an artist. If your name wasn't Miller, Williams, or O'Neill, you basically weren't in print as an American playwright. Much of the work that we do is with practicing playwrights, and they were not being celebrated or preserved outside of some poorly produced acting editions. We began basing our philosophy of publishing on the playwright, not the play. Our goal, once we chose a playwright to publish, was to publish their work for their entire career, whether they are successes or not. Tonight we have Kathy Sova, who's with us tonight, and Majaski, who are both editors. Kathy's been with TCG for 20 years and has edited countless plays, has worked with probably the greatest collection of American playwrights you can imagine. Our goal was to produce first-class editions printed on great paper with text and typography special for each book. Each book has its own cover design. We try to select a designer who we think fits the work of that writer. We try to treat each play that we publish like Knopf and Farrar Straus would with their fiction writers. And that was our goal. That's if you can shoot that high, you might as well shoot for publishers like that. The author has complete approval of the entire production, the cover, everything inside the book. We've had some wonderful covers that our authors didn't like. We have them in our drawer back at work. But if they don't like it, they don't think it represents their work, it does not make any sense to put it on something that they did. Our other commitment to our writers is that every single play by an author or anthology by that author would remain in print. So no books in 30 years have gone out of print that we've published. As of today, our list includes over 400 titles and 100 playwrights. To give you a general list of some of our writers, Atho Fugard, we've published 16 books by, Carol Churchill, 12, Eric Bogosian, 10, Stephen Sondheim, Tony Kushner, and Donald Margulies, 9, Susan Laurie Park, 7 books, Sarah Rule, David Henry Wong, Nilo Cruz, and Will Eno, 6 books, Lynn Nottage and Paul Vogel, 5 each. We also commit to publishing at least one new writer each year, if not more. And we feel that it needs to be representative of the whole field, where women playwrights and writers in color are fully engaged. Over the last 5 years, new writers to our list included Terrell Alvin McCraney, Stephen Natalie Gerges, Stephen Karam, Young Jean Lee, Thomas Bradshaw, Amy Baker, Amy Herzog, Samuel Hunter, Kiara Alegria-Hudes, and Denai Gurga, and in the next few months we'll be publishing Ann Washburn and Brandon Jacobs Jenkins. We've been fortunate enough to publish 14 plays that have won the Pulitzer Prize. Last year, just to give you a kind of a scale of what we do, we sold 135,000 books in print editions, another 30,000 in ebooks. Since 1980, we've sold something like 3.5 million books and something like 100K ebooks. This pales in comparison to 50 Shades of Grey and The Hunger Games, but for theater books, it ain't bad. Our best-selling book of all time is Tony Kushner's Angels in America, which is now approaching something like 700,000 copies sold. It was first published in 1992, and it really did take the book program to another level entirely. In the first few years, it accounted for almost 50% of our sales. Tony worked at TCG for a year in 1988 as a director of literary services, and we worked together on a number of projects, including a dramatist source book and selecting plays that we published in American Theater Magazine. I knew he was a playwright, and he went to NYU. He said he'd been working on a new play for a while and would be interested in publishing it when it was done. Well, as anyone would say in that situation to a fellow employee, I said, sure. The best sure I think I've ever said in my life. It says something about Tony that 24 years later, he is still with the same publisher and with the same agent that he started with. That's kind of a record if you know the field. His support has been essential to the success of TCG Books. Another singular moment was our work with August Wilson. The first 6 plays that August published were with N.A.L. Plume, which now is owned by Penguin Random House. And his editor in those days was Arnold Dolan. We had always wanted to work with August, but he was well published, and so we sort of kind of watched from afar. We published his famous speech, The Ground on Which I Stand, which he delivered at a TCG conference in 1996. So over the years, as we watched, unbelievably enough, N.A.L. Plume fired Arnold Dolan, who was one of the great theater editors who ever worked in New York. And within about 2 year time, we were able to publish King Hedley II. So all our waiting finally paid off. Shortly thereafter, we did Gem of the Ocean, and August came to us and he said he really wanted to have all 10 volumes of his century cycle when done, there was one more to go, published in a cloth version, a hardback version, box set. And once again, our answer was sure, and as sure as the day is long. How we got August Wilson, which I forgot to tell you, is that he sent Jitney to N.A.L. Plume after his editor left, and they sent him back a letter saying that they didn't accept unsolicited submissions. So they had forgotten that they published August Wilson. He had already won 2 Pulitzer Prizes, and they had published 6 plays by the man. So that was an opening that you could drive a truck through, obviously. So shortly after the book was finally published in September of 2007, that was 2 years after August passed away, and we did it in a fine, fine cloth with his signature kind of etched on the front cover. And these are the books when he was a kid that he would hold and read when he was in Pittsburgh at the library, where he pretty much educated himself. And to him, this was the kind of a crowning achievement to have his work published. And we were honored to be able to do that. We do other play publications, do a series of anthologies, the most recent being Inside Outside, 6 plays from Palestine and the Diaspora, edited by Naomi Wallace and Ishmael Khalidi. Other anthologies we've published have included solo performers, African-American women, playwrights with disabilities, ensemble theater work, hip-hop theater, Native American plays, Middle Eastern American plays. We also publish work on theory and practice written by artists themselves, including the Viewpoints book by Ann Bogart and Tina Landau, Theater of the Oppressed by Augusto Boal, Ridiculous Theater by Charles Ludlam, books by Peter Hall, Peter Brook, Kristen Linkletter, and Richard Maxwell. We do interview books with playwrights, directors, and designers. Boy, that's a lot, right? But it took a long time to do it. Besides our own publishing program, we also exclusively represent 10 other publishers in the United States. As Frank said, we distribute for Martin E. Segal Theater Publications, PAJ Publications, 53rd State Press, and Ansha is here from 53rd State Press, Chance Magazine, Padua Hills Playwright Center, Play Scripts, Inc. From the UK, we distribute Nick Hearn Books, Oberon Books, Aurora Metro Press, and from Canada, we do Playwrights Canada Press. These other publishers bring in another 2,500 titles, so this list altogether is probably the biggest collection of theater and drama books assembled in one place. There are hundreds and hundreds of translations that these other publishers have bring to us. So it's if you want to see their work, you can go to tcg.org and look at the TCG bookstore, or go to the individual sites of these publishers. I think I've said enough. Frank?
Wonderful, thank you so much.
Should I introduce Kameron, or do you want to introduce Kameron?
Yeah, these two, but thank you for this great overview, and really one can get an idea how vast really the contribution of the field is, also Ms. Kathy and everybody else involved, so thank you. And,
okay.
Tell us a bit about the book project.
Okay, I will. We're lucky enough to have Kameron Steele with us tonight, who's a translator of the Suzuki book, Culture is the Body, the Theater Writings of, it's not there, of Tadashi Suzuki, author, director, teacher, translator, longtime Suzuki collaborator. He has also worked extensively with Robert Wilson, and he's the co-director of the Suzuki Method of Actor Training at the summer program in Togo, amongst a gazillion other things which are in his bio in the back of the book. So Cameron's going to be introducing our video. Should we just go right to the video? Is that the
good? Deal? Maybe say a little bit about the project and the process.
Sure.
I just want to say one thing about the video that Cameron's going to introduce. That the beginning of it talks about Peter Zeisler. And Peter Zeisler was the executive director of TCG for many years. It started in the 70s, and he wasn't really one who expanded TCG. He was one of the original founders of the Guthrie Theater in 1965 with Tyrone Guthrie.
Hello, everyone. It's really great to see so many different faces from so many different phases of my own life. here. So thank you so much for coming to see our presentation. The video we're going to show you now was filmed at the end of last summer's season in Toga, which is where Tadashi Suzuki and the Scott Company have their home base. And it was, we had wanted to have Suzuki be here live to speak to you all via Skype. But what is happening right now for Mr. Suzuki is he's opening a production of The Bakai at this brand new theater right in front of the Great Wall near Beijing. And so it's a big project, and there in Beijing now it's about 7 a.m. And he told me, please don't wake me up for this, let's just make a video. So that's what we did. But it's, we really did it sort of on the fly one afternoon in Toga after everything had sort of died down, the summer activities. But it was amazing to me sort of how quickly he was able to not only summarize his relationship with TCG and American theater, but really give us this strong message propelling us into the future. You know, it reminded me, I was talking with Bob about this earlier. You know, someone had asked him, why should American Theater Magazine be interested or care about international theater? And it reminded me of something that Bob said once, Robert Wilson, about André Malraux, who was the French Minister of Culture for a time, and he was one of the people that discovered Robert Wilson. He said, half of our effort as a cultural ministry should be to preserve the art of the past, and another half should be to support the art of the future. And at the same time, he said, half of our effort should be to support French arts, and the other half should be to support the arts of the world. And I thought that perspective was fascinating. And it's a perspective that I think is what attracted me to Suzuki in the first place. And he'll talk about that and many other things in this video. And I hope you find it as inspiring as I still do today after 25 years working with the man. So without further ado, here's the interview we did last September in Toga.
お互いに。それぞれ違う国の有名な劇曲を演出して、すごく面白い。 豊かな歴史、これから本があって、皆 archaic operations, so forth. But they're really comfortable with my type of work here.
みんなが楽しむためにある。 2人で作ったので、長いこと作って活躍して、運用を取ってきたので、カメラと、この行動サインという意味で、
Again, congratulations. And yes, there was a wonderful compliment Tadashi Suzuki gave you there at the end. I'm sure it is well deserved because he does not do that lightly, even so he did it with a smile. Tell us, why Tadashi Suzuki book? Why were you so interested in working on it? How long? How did it start?
Well, I joined Suzuki's company right after I graduated from Northwestern, which was in 1991, and we started working on the book in 92. And then in 94, I left Suzuki's company. I went to work in commercial theater here in the United States for about 3 years before I started working at Watermill in 98, and I worked there for a while. And so it wasn't
Watermill is Robert Wilson's art and training and project and museum and...
Exactly, yeah. And so, we worked really intensely from 92 to 93. Four on the book, but then it sat around for about 15 years. And then in 2009, I started working with Suzuki again, and we brought it back up, and we were like, wow, this is a mess. We need to work on this some more, and it took us about 5 years. And then in the process of doing that, we discovered a whole new direction we wanted the book to go in, and so we actually ended up rewriting the original Japanese book that it was mostly based on. And so actually there doesn't exist a Japanese version of this English book anymore. So now he's actually translating this English back into Japanese. Because a lot of it came out through, it was sort of crazy because when, Ellen and some other people that are here that have worked in Toga can attest to, it's like, we're working 14-hour days there. We're up at 8 and we stop rehearsal around 10, 11, and it was at 11 at night that we would sit together and work every night to work on this translation. So we did that for a couple summers, and that's how it happened. But in the process of that, he discovered a lot. Like he says at the end, it was our conversation that created a lot of the book. And so one thing I like to think of it as is a little bit like the conversation that Barba and Grotowski had that ended up becoming Towards a Poor Theater. I'd like to think of this book as sort of having that kind of resonance, that kind of impact, because I do think his ideas go beyond his being Japanese and his history. They really touch on something that all of us, and not just as theater artists, but as human beings living in this time, need to get back to, which is live, how important liveness is, and how important liveness is threatened in our time, and I think the theater could go one way, which is what I hope it goes in, which is it's going to become even more important as people get stuck behind these devices in their daily life. They'll need this kind of immediacy that the theater has, or we'll shut down, and we'll just, it'll be, Terminator or something like that. But I hope that it doesn't go that way. I think it won't, because I think at the end of the day, we are animals. We have a kind of a social need to exist in time and space that's shared. And so I think that really simple message is important, and I think all of the specifics of his message that get fleshed out in the book are important. So that's one of the reasons why I'm so enthusiastic about it. And just personally, I think being able to be a bridge between Suzuki and certainly my own culture, but also the entire English-speaking world, is important because I think what can happen with, in particular, Japanese artists is they can be sort of thought of as like, oh, well, that's Japanese, oh, that's this Oriental thing, oh, that has nothing to do with me. And the way I've tried to contextualize the book is really emphasize this idea that no, in fact, what he's talking about isn't this esoteric, contemporary version of Kabuki. It's ideas and themes and a philosophy that really resonate in our time. It's not Yes, it comes from this culturally specific place, but if you're open to it, it can resonate in many different ways, and that's my hope for the book.
Yeah, it is truly remarkable to think in a time where so much happens and so fast that you guys actually took 15 years of time and rethink it and rework it, actually what he said at the end that what theater should be doing, you actually also did with the book. But tell us, what did you discover? What changed? What was the, what you said we had to do differently? What was the essence of that?
Well, I think it became, in a way, more about, because when he originally wrote it, it was in the 80s. And, certainly the, virtual reality was not dictating everyone's daily life in the way it is now. So that's the main thing that was different. But then I think also his relationship with the training, in particular, as he said, the Suzuki method is something that's been practiced pretty regularly in the United States now for about 25 years. And when he first shared it with the world, it sort of had one, it was, I would say, what he would say is that it was very connected, more connected to his aesthetic. And one of the things he's tried to do is he's reworked it in, I think starting around 2006, he tried to really recontextualize the training. In particular, and reduce it down to what he felt was really the essence of the training that could be applicable to anybody doing any kind of style. It really was reworking what are the basic parameters of a performer. So that's sort of on the practice side, that's what he did. And then that reevaluation of the practice, making it more universal and not so connected to his own aesthetic, caused him to then reevaluate his whole philosophy and how to bring that into a bigger scope and communicate that. He talks about the Theater Olympics in 1984 as his first connection with Peter Zeisler, but that Olympics actually created a Theater Olympics, which the book is dedicated to a woman named Ikuko Saito, who was Suzuki's managing director for most of the history of the company. She passed away recently. But she was the mastermind behind what is called the Theater Olympics, and the Theater Olympics have been happening every few years, basically since 1995 was the first one. And that took a lot of the ideas that were at the Los Angeles Cultural Olympics and then created this event that started Theo Terzopoulos's Attis Theater in Greece was the first company that hosted the Olympics. They occurred in Delphi in 1995, and then it was in Shizuoka where Suzuki was. Yuri Lubimov hosted it in Moscow. It was then in Istanbul and in Korea and recently in China. And it will be in Brusilov next year. Yaroslav Fret from the Theater Tsar will be artistic director of that festival. But anyway, it snowballed into his really trying to expand his work into a forum where these kinds of ideas could be discussed across cultures. So that all of those events then colored how he wanted to reshape his writing that happened in the 80s when we approached it again in 2009.
He talks about the animal spirit. For the audience, talk a little bit what is his idea?
Culture is the body. Is based on this idea that, a lot of our bodies, basically since the Industrial Revolution, we're depending on machines to do what, the human body did, and that has had its effect on the performing arts, the way he contextualizes the article, Culture is the Body, is he says, the way, anthropologists will talk about whether a society is civilized or not will depend on, what percentage of their manufacturing is done by animal energy versus non-animal energy. And the more non-animal energy they use to produce things, it means they're more civilized, right? But his thinking is that, in fact, the more their everyday processes are dependent on non-animal energy, the less vital their culture is. That's his basic argument.
And non-animal energy means animals in a sense, or the human spirit as an animal?
Well, non-animal energy is anything that's run off of power that's not animal. So it's anything that's electricity or gas or anything that's run by machines, basically, as opposed to things that are organically powered. They're powered by animals or by human labor. So he uses this argument, which is basically an anthropological argument, and then applies it to the theater. So that's when he talks about animal energy, and those, if you're familiar with his training, the idea is to bring the, you know, the 21st century, late 20th century actor who's, you know, trained mostly in, you know, how to train his brain and his psychology and his emotion or his or her emotional life, you know, to reconnect that with the body, because at some point in the actor's training that got compromised, or it started to be called dance, or it started to be called something else. And the actors in the latter half of the 20th century and the 21st century have lost a kind of scales, you know, how to train the body, or it's become very compartmentalized. You have the voice teacher, you have the mind teacher, you have the dance teacher. And so his idea was to create a system that would bring back the totality of the actor's work into one system.
Yeah, and after all, theater does not write an article, it's not a discussion, it is actually a body on stage, it's an actor on stage. This is the main difference, you know, of it is any discussion in other art forms. It's not a painting, it's not a poem, it is a body on stage representing ideas, representing history, and all of it. There's the famous book of Master Seami, which just shows also how Japanese theater has developed. It was a secret book. It was a family book taught from one generation to the other. No one was allowed to read it because perhaps other families would find out and take it in advantage in the big competitions. And here we have Tadashi Suzuki, who basically has a dialogue with the world and sees his art as a universal practice of it. Tell us a bit about the person. What kind of person is he? Well, how is he to work with? And,
Yeah. Well, he's a very charming man. I mean, to talk a little bit more about Suzuki's legacy. I mean, he is personally responsible for not just Toga, but he and Saito together, they created two other art centers in Japan besides the one you have here. So you can, to put it in American terms, it's sort of like he made, so let's say that he created Wolf Trap, if you know that, the facility outside of Washington, D.C., maybe that's roughly like Shizuoka. And then he made the Kennedy Center, and then he also made a Lincoln Center, basically. He created these different, you know, most of them with Isozaki, the architect, Arata Isozaki. He's responsible for the creation of these major cultural institutions that were supporting him for years. I mean, I guess the closest thing we maybe have to him is somebody like Guthrie. You know, he had this vision, was able to then, you know, create structures that supported that. So that's kind of incredible in and of itself, to see the impact he's had and how he's created in Japan a way for it to be, you know, long into the future, internationally engaged. So that's impressive. Personally, you know, he grew up in the days immediately following World War II. You know, he was a young child when it ended, and so he was in Shizuoka, and the sounds of bombs exploding around him as a child are in his body. The sounds of American pop songs of the 50s being played in the jeeps of the American GIs running around are in his brain. And a lot of these things come out in his work. You know, it's a very explosive work. It's you hear these weird, you hear, you know, Chubby Checker and songs like this in the training and in his work, and also the pop songs of the time. These impressions that he had as a child come out in his aesthetic work, and I think he has a kind of like childlike approach to everything he does. On the other hand, he's an incredible taskmaster. I mean, he's very strict, and he comes from the school of people like Tadeusz Kantor and Gratowski, and he sets the bar very high for all of us that have worked for him. I've never, you know, even working for Bob, Robert Wilson, who's very demanding as well. No one has ever put the bar as high for me as an actor or an artist as he has. And it's climbing that mountain every time you work for him it takes a significant spiritual and physical effort. And so I think one of the things I try to do as a director when I work with actors is give them a similar challenge, you know, but trying to do it within the context of American theater.
Maybe as a last question before we come to Rob, you are a translator of the book, which of course is a very personal relationship, which we see, and a wonderful relationship as it looks from the outside, and not everybody is as fortunate to have it. You're also a director, and a lot of people say directing a play is also translating it, but on stage. For you, what is the most meaningful lesson you learned, or what did you really, if you say, you could say this is the most significant difference after I met him, after I did this book, and something for you personally that changed?
Well, I think the big thing you have to create if you're a director is you have to create a kind of grammar. You have to create a company. It's not about individuals. It's about creating a way in which a group of people can change a space, that you as an audience go in there and suddenly you're in a different world. And that starts with the actors being able to share a kind of new performance grammar that they work on every day, and there's a continuity to it. The problem with commercial theaters, you're always jobbing in people, and they all have a very different experience, and how do you make them all speak the same language in a short period of time? And because you're always working with like a 6 to 8 week performance limitation, you can only get so far, which is why the idea of company is so important. So it's why companies like the City Company, the companies like what they're trying to do at the Wilma Theater right now, Blanka Ziska, she's trying to create their, Terzopoulos is directing there now, and his training is going to be part of that company that she's making. This idea of creating, you know, certainly Worcester Group has this as well, this idea of a long-standing company that over years has developed. You know, Yvonne and the Wax Factory have been trying to do this too. You know, that over years you develop a language. And that's what the theater needs. And it takes a long time to cook that. There's no shortcut to that. It takes the time. And if you look at the history of the theater, the strongest theater has always been the company. You know, whether it's, you know, the Brecht's Theater, or whether it's the RSC, or whether it's the companies I've just mentioned here, you need that. Mnuchin's company, right, or Pina Bausch's company. You need that continuity to make something interesting, to make something that's going to change a space. And so that's the biggest lesson I take.
Wonderful. Thank you so very, very much. And as we see Tadashi Suzuki's work, of course, he was very close to the heart and to the mind, you know, of the whole work here at the Segal Theater Center, but also as we learned from the video, TCG has played a very, very big role, a bit behind the scenes, but, you know, almost one said, what would have happened, you know, if the editor wouldn't have met him at the Olympics? And so there's a great, great influence that happened. So TCG plays, as all great editors, also in publishing houses, do make very, very significant roles, very personal, also in close to the life of the artists. One part of TCG also, to get the word out and to discuss issues of contemporary theater, of American theater, but also theater from around the world, is of course the American Theater Magazine, and which has, as we will learn, for over 25 years now, really been perhaps the most visible, the highest edition theater magazine, I think, in the U.S. And also for just from the numbers Terry mentioned earlier, a real force in the theater. So Rob, maybe. First of all, thank you again for coming, and maybe share with us some ideas, and maybe you can draw some connections to this. Whatever you feel more comfortable, maybe you go over there.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. My experience with Suzuki, not personally, but. Years ago, I think you know this, Ellen. I think, and I talked to you about this, Cameron. Just as a sort of gift to me, Kim Wield and Anthony Byrne, they had the Burning Wheel Company in Los Angeles, had me do the training at Shakespeare Center LA and out there when I was there, and it was transformative. I have to say, I never wrote a big piece about it. I think that might have been the thinking of the right one, but I still run into Leon and Bondo all the time, and it was transformative. And I'll just say a few words. That'll factor into my comments. I was just asked to say a few words about the future of American Theater Magazine in the digital age, and it's hard for me to, here's our website, to talk about it without talking also about the, you know, what I see as the state and the future of American theater in general. But first, you know, because actually our fates are intertwined, actually literally intertwined, because we're a membership-driven organization, and because I came up in Los Angeles, where artists are scrappy and making theater with almost no compensation, I always felt guilty that I had a job. I was editor of Backstage West, I had a full-time job with benefits, and a lot of people I covered just, you know, were just doing it on a wing and a prayer. And I used to feel like I don't think theater artists' lives have materially improved radically. That's certainly an understatement. But I feel like the shoe's on the other foot a little bit. Sometimes I feel like I worry less about the future of the theater and theater artists than about the future of journalism, and the future of arts journalism in particular. When you look at the way that theater coverage at even the legacy papers in New York, which is supposedly the theater and publishing capital of the country, Backstage has cut theater reviews. The New York Post has cut way back on its theater reviews. Even the New York Times recently has stopped listing the artists at the end of the reviews. That's something that playwrights are really upset about. So the coverage seems to be shrinking, and this is an industry-wide journalism issue that I and my field and my colleagues in other fields have been scratching our heads about. And one of the solutions that's been suggested is nonprofit ways to fund journalism for the future. So there's ProPublica, which does funds investigative journalism, and then there's another solution people have talked about. And there are some colleagues who are dramaturgs and journalists who are no longer employed by the daily paper in their area. John Moore at the Denver Post was the last critic at the Denver Post, and now he works for the Denver Center for the Performing Arts. And so that people have talked about embedded journalists, that somehow arts organizations could bring journalists in to help reach their audience, explain their audience. Obviously, that's not an ideal solution because it's not independent. I think what we have with American theater is sort of a middle way. We're not doing hard-hitting investigative journalism about the ills of the American theater, but we're also not simply the house organ of any one theater. We are ad-supported. We also have subscribers, so that's a big part of our bottom line. But we also are a membership. We consider good journalism to be a service to the field. And part of what TCG does. So it's kind of a miracle, actually. It's been 30 years it's been around. And when Peter Zeisler and Lindy Zhesh and Terry and founded the magazine, hired Jim O'Quinn, my predecessor, to create it, the idea was really that the field needed a general readership publication, which there hadn't been one since the 60s, since theater arts folded. And there were academics journals, which are great, but there was something that for a newsstand publication to cover the theater. And what my predecessor and I and my staff's all here tonight, what we've learned to do over the years is to thread the needle so that we can write about the challenges and the triumphs and reflect and respond to what the theater is going through and what the theater needs. In a way that is responsible. We don't run criticism of particular shows, partly because of our timing, because we're monthly. But I can talk about, we're actually a lot more frequent than monthly now, and I can talk about that in a second. Briefly, we put out 10 print issues a year, but I figured out the other day we have about 250 online days a year that we have to put content up. Now, all of our print content ends up, that was a print article. All of our print content ends up as online content as well. So, but we do a lot of online-only coverage as well. So we can be more timely, more responsive to the field. We also do in thinking forward what to do with print issues, because you know so much readership is online. We still have an opportunity in each print issue to do long-form pieces and to cover themes. Every year we do a global issue about global focus of a different kind each year, Latin America or Asia or whatever our focus is, or international collaboration. We do a training issue each January, and we do a season preview in October. But I think one of the things I've started to do since I took over in July is to think of each issue as an opportunity to focus on one particular issue or theme. So the current issue, November, which is just about to come out, is focused on disability and disabled artists in the theater. Our December one, sort of whimsically, is on science fiction and fantasy as a genre in the theater, which seems to be catching on. And January, as I said, a training issue, and so on. We're going to go throughout the year. We also are probably going to do an annual design and tech issue, which is something we cover. We've covered, but we haven't. You know, we don't do the annual focus each year. So let's see. It's been pointed out, you know, it's not an original thought to talk about the precious, rare liveness of people gathering in a room at an appointed time, not on demand whenever they want to binge watch it, or they have to gather in a room and share and think and feel at the same time. I think that is a unique power that theater still possesses, and I think our challenge as people write about theater is to live up to that and compete with the noise that's online and in print and draw on that power. And we have also a unique responsibility because of theater's ephemerality and locality to really speak to that and reflect that and respond to it and record. We have a real duty to record. And an opportunity. It's not just a duty, it's an opportunity. It's one I gladly get up every day and have to think about. To record the art that is passing, you know, like water on the stage. You know, we do an annual theater facts report. TCG has like a data division that looks at, you know, how theaters are doing economically. And that's also in our November issue. And I'll say the theater's in pretty good shape, actually, the American theater, financially. But obviously the challenges and the theater's health is not measured by numbers like the stock market. It really is about how well it's speaking to the current moment and who's in the room, who's making the theater and who's watching it. I am encouraged and sanguine myself. I mean, I guess it's kind of my job to be, but I also am encouraged and sanguine because I feel like there's a generational change. I am part of it. From sort of the boomers to Gen X, you might say. But I also think mine is a generation that grew up, you know, thinking of City as our actor studio, really. And thinking of August Wilson as our Arthur Miller. And Culture Clash as our ridiculous theater company. This is the theater we grew up with and took for granted the resident theater movement that was sort of the establishment. Steppenwolf and Wooster Group are like the establishment to us. But I feel like if you follow the career of someone like Bill Rausch, who I did had the great good fortune to follow when Cornerstone moved to LA in the early 90s, he's someone who, when he got out of Harvard in 86, said, I don't want any part of this resident theater movement. I want to go make theater out in the, you know, where there is no theater. And I think now that he's the head of one of the largest theaters in the country, Oregon Shakespeare Festival, I think he's not only moved forward, I think the field has met him. And I think the field is a different field and a more diverse and responsive field than it was when he got in a van with his colleagues in 86. I was just to say also, it's a lot more work to do an online publication while also doing a print publication, but I will say it helps us do our job a lot better because there's a lot more that going on in the American theater, it's a big country, and in the world theater, than we can cover with 10 print issues. So we're able to do our, I think it makes us more responsive and better at our jobs, even though it's a bigger job, and my staff works really hard. I don't know if I have anything more to add. I want to turn it over to questions at some point. If anyone has questions about what we're doing with American theater.
Maybe we go just directly to questions.
Let's go, let's all sit.
Yeah, so thank you so much.
Sure.
So again, Terry and Kameron, thank you so much for sharing with you your work and your experience, and we are really quite fortunate to be here all with you. We're a little bit also perhaps closer to the evening than we thought, and before we maybe go to audience questions, we should go right away. There is so much talk, as you mentioned, your publishing is, you know, perishing, and now this is this thing that needs to be saved. Before it was perhaps the theater, but in a way, theater is blooming. Broadway has, you know, big audiences. More and more companies, spaces are being built. We have to redefine, in a way, the field. What are also practices you kind of you follow? All of you, where you think there might be something that will save us. A great German poet, Hölderlin, said, "Wherever there's danger, there's also something gross that will save us." Right. So what do you see? I mean, you mentioned a little bit.
I didn't get to some of the artists who are working now. I wasn't joking when I said it. I feel like companies like City, like Wooster Group, like Cornerstone, influenced a whole generation of theater makers who are like the Rudmecs and like Pig Iron, who really are doing theater, I mean, in the way that people, you know, bands make music. I think Pig Iron is the one that has said, I think it's Dan Rothenberg, says people who see their shows say, they debated whether to take the name theater off their, out of their brand, basically, because people who go see Pig Iron shows say, "I like what Pig Iron does, I don't like theater, I like what Pig Iron does." Because I think there is a young audience that does follow groups in that way. And I'm also encouraged and intrigued by another trend that I just witnessed, Futurity at Soho Rep, this group called The Lisps. And it's a trend that I've followed as someone who loves, hates musical theater, you know, and who loves when it's great and is heartbroken when it's terrible, which is a lot of times. And this trend of people making, in the way that theater companies devise work, bands making musicals that way, making music theater that is you know, and it's responsive to a younger audience. I mean, I think there are playwrights also who work in an old-fashioned playwright and director way who are doing similar things. Brandon, Jacob Jenkins, and folks like that.
One of the things that we do at TCG and American Theater Magazine, we publish a complete play script 5 times a year, and it's an incredible place for us to find new writers. And every year we find people we've never heard of before that just blow your mind by what they're doing. Their work is so extraordinary, and that every time you think you've read something that has really taken you as far as you're going to go, you read something and you go a little bit further. Mm-hmm. And this is before it's even on stage. So the great thing that we have at TCG and at American Theater and the book program is that we get to read all these people at a very early point in their career and sort of go through this journey together with them. And it's really kind of an extraordinary honor to be able to do that.
I was going to say, if you look at groups like the Living Theater, you know, who really, you know, try, or the Japanese artist Terry Yamashuji was another one who tried to get out of the model of the proscenium theater with the actors there and the audience here, you know, following these ideas of rancières, you know, to emancipate the spectator. I think that all of that is, I mean, I think that moment is happening, has been happening for a while. At the same time, I would say we need to look at what the classical existence of the actor was, and what was the actor before television? What was the actor before? From what kind of training did they? That's the thing I think we've maybe lost in the theater. How do we go back to get more viscerally potent performances and more viscerally potent companies before there was this division between the dancer and the actor and the musician? You know, how can we reinvestigate perhaps what we've lost during the 20th century? I think that there's another effort to be made there. Because right now I see a lot of companies really working hard to use video, for example. And this is, again, this addition of a non-animal element into the theater in a way, you know, there's all this trying to have theater compete with these other media. You have the TV stars coming in and being on shows and Broadway and stuff. And that's really, I think we need to interrogate that and say, well, what is the theater really about? And Grotowski talks about this. It's an actor and another person looking at that actor, and that visceral relationship, and how to enrich that, and how can we rediscover that? Because I think a lot of that, and we're still recovering that, and I think a lot of people see that and are making those efforts, but I think we need to stay on that point more, especially in American theater.
Thank you. And maybe Michael and Brad, we put some lights also up on the audiences, and we go over to you guys, and it's such a fantastic audience, brilliant audience here. I'm sure you have some questions for all of them, and we will come with a mic, and I will start and see what. So we are recording you, so that's fine.
Okay, thank you. This is a question for Rob. I think, and my preamble is that I think one of the more imaginative uses of online journalism, if you will, is Hal Brown. And I was wondering whether or not they had come to TCG, to American Theater, when they were starting up, and talked with you about what their strategies were, and whether or not what Hal Brown does has had any impact on what you're doing online.
You know, I think we've been on parallel tracks, and we definitely, I wrote a big story when they started that program, Polly and David and the fellow who's at Arts Emerson, I forget his name, he's not there anymore. Oh, Rob Orchard, is that him? Yeah. There was sort of a triumvirate, they started that. And we consider them, you know, friendly colleagues. We'd started, before we had a full online presence, TCG Circle, which is a blog. And it gives voice to the artist, and it does something sort of similar to what HowlRound does, but without kind of the regularity and sort of discipline. HowlRound is like every day. And I curated a week on HowlRound. So I think there's a collegial relationship that we have with them, and we share a lot of their content on social media. And we probably could do more coordination in a way, although I think, in a way, I think, to be honest with you, when they first came out, I thought, oh, that's something we should have done, right? So it was sort of independently arrived at, but we don't really see them as competition. We also, what they don't do is a sort of legacy journalism reporting. They don't do news reporting per se. Although, you know, they've sometimes done scoops in there that are really interesting. So we pay close attention to what they're doing, and I think they do to us as well. And I'm collegial with Polly, who edits it. But I think it does something slightly different. I mean, I think it hands the mic, if you will, to a lot of different voices. And we definitely try to do that as well. I think we do a little more, somewhere between traditional news reporting and curating. And then also we have lots of op-eds, you know, sometimes controversial ones. We have a mix like that. So it feels a little more like a magazine or a newspaper. But also, it's a field with lots of voices, and we want to include as many as possible. So, yeah.
Thanks for the question.
Thank you. My question is actually directed to Kameron, but to the others as well. What really fascinated me about what you said about this, the Tadashi dichotomy between the animal energy and technology, if you will. Some time ago, we went to see a play, I think it was a Next Wave Festival at BAM, Taiwanese group, I think it was Cloud Tail Rise. What they were doing was that they were, it's dance theater, but they were using a whole lot of projections. So what was happening was that you didn't have language really, in terms of text. But this entire thing was a very interesting production. And it was, I have to say, it was extremely energy transferring, if that's the right word to use. So what does that mean? You know, you said it is something that we need to explore, but what does that also mean in terms of publishing? How does one publish something like that?
Well, I mean, that's all. How do you articulate in words something which is physical? You know, how can you, Anne Bogart talks a lot about the violence of language. You know, when you talk about something, suddenly you're violent with it because somehow you're putting it in this box that can never hope to get close to what the real thing is. But I think it's the attempt to articulate these experiences and these. And here I am, you know, I don't mean to badmouth video design, used video designers as a lot as a director, but I think you have to interrogate, you just have to ask these questions. Like, is the video helping to enhance the physical experience that's happening in the moment, or is it taking the place of that? I just think it brings up many different questions, and I think the writing about these things can help us articulate these questions even more. It's, I think, as artists and as writers about the arts, I think it's important not to try to create a product or to create an answer, but really try to refine the kinds of questions we're asking and to interrogate, you know, how they resonate in the times that we live in. And so I think that's, I know this group that you're talking about, and they're incredible physical performers. They just saw the documentary album called The Walkers, which is a great documentary if you can see it on this company. But the physical work translates through the medium of cinema. And so if you can successfully do that, I think that's certainly is worthwhile as a live performance. And I think if it inspires people to think about things in a new way, then of course it's valid. It's the function of art.
Thank you very much. It was really a wonderful presentation from all of you. My question is for both Terry and Kameron, I suppose. I wonder if you could talk a bit about the literary component of the theater. I'm thinking, for example, of Stage Fright by Martin Puttner, his book, where he sort of traces a genealogy of a theater of philosophy, Greek theater, the Tribunal, Bernard Shaw. And it's fascinating that Kushner, who I think above all sort of manifests this, also manifests a kind of literariness. I'm a playwright, so I'm biased, but I also teach theater, and I teach playwrights, a lot of them American playwrights in other countries. And I wonder if you could address the extent to which, this is part of the same question I think she was asking, this representation or complexity of literary texts now. Surely August Wilson and Kushner exemplify it. Were they almost an end point? And now we're seeing theater coming from other directions and the literary text in American theater especially beginning to wither away.
Oof, wither away. To me, in terms of publishing that we do in the book program, particularly the play publishing, there are so many more plays and writers that should be published that we can't publish. We publish about 25 books a year, and there has to be dozens more who are very talented writers that we just can't support. What there needs to be is more publishers, not less, because I think we've been in a golden age of playwriting for the last 15, 20 years. And all I see is that it's getting better. There's no shortage. There are a lot more opportunities for playwrights, obviously, in places like television, but that's helping to pay the rent. And there's some pretty good TV because of that, because of those playwrights. So I think there's lots of opportunities, more so now than before. And you know, when we look at the women playwrights that we published in the last 3 years, the extraordinary talent that's in that group alone is it's hard to keep up with because they're just doing such new, challenging work. So I don't think it's a problem. I don't think it's an end of something. I think it's just a great beginning of something even better in terms of playwriting. Does that make any sense? No.
Well, I mean, certainly the beginning of On Directing, the chapter in the book, Suzuki right away interrogates the idea that you have to choose a play first and then start to make a piece of theater. you know, his view is, I would say, closer to Robert Wilson's, in that he sees text as, you know, another kind of material that you use to create a performance. That being said, Suzuki, you know, works almost exclusively, I mean, now he's branching out again like he did in his early days, in texts that are, you know, I would say, more devised, or he cobbles them together from a variety of texts. But in general, he has one main classical text that he's working with, and then he'll add in, for example, in the Bacchae, it's mostly the Euripides text, and he'll put in a little bit of, you know, Beckett's Cascando at the end of it or something. He's using text as a kind of material, but there are these classic texts that have been, you know, proved themselves over many, you know, years. So I think what he interrogates is sort of the process of the assumption that you have to have the text first in order to make theater. That really the creation of theater, that actually happened, you know, at the turn of the 19th to 20th century, when playwrights became these literary figures, where you had like Chekhov and Ibsen, these folks become these huge literary figures. Where before that, text was something that was created more in the moment. You know, it was something that was, you know, certainly the writers for Kabuki, they were creating material to support the various movement and improvisations of those actors. So I think it's in our time, and then of course with the, you know, the onset of film and television, this idea that you need to have the text first before you can even begin any kind of production because of the cost involved, right? So I think that what's nice about the time we live in now is you have this idea of devised work and work happening that a company creates together as being a big part of how the script gets made. That the old model of like one person alone writing a script and then handing it over to a company or a director is now loosening up again. So you have texts happening in many different ways. And then what ends up getting published is the final result. But there are many different processes that go into how that text actually ended up getting made.
Thank you.
Did you?
This comment question is for everyone. For me, what is deeply exciting about tonight is that the book is written in collaboration, you know, with Suzuki by a practitioner, someone who is, you know, in many ways, you know, either behind the scenes or maybe in the book, testifying to the event of performance, and then, you know, through the very specific perspectives of you as training under, training now with, and I'm curious for all three, you know, I would love to read about actor writers. You know, I would love to read that first person, and you know, we have memoirs, of course, but you know, testifying from the performance event, you know, that sort of ground zero moment, to me is deeply exciting. And I'm wondering, Kameron, if you can speak a little bit to how your work as a practitioner informed your collaboration writing book?
Well, one of the first books I actually read about acting was Laurence Olivier's book on acting. It's kind of embarrassing, but it's, you know, he had sort of the Confessions of an Actor, which was all about his personal life, but then he had this other book on acting where he actually talked about the craft. And one of the things I always quote from him in this book is, you know, the best actors have the strongest hips, you know, but things like that. It was this practitioner's basically a recording of his time on stage, and it was fascinating to me. I was like 17 when I read, and I had, you know, been doing mostly musicals, but it was, this book really opened up my thinking about it. And anyway, as an actor working with Suzuki, I think, and as somebody who's done the training and, you know, as an actor learning it and then as a teacher of it, I think one of the things that a lot of actors struggle with is this idea of fiction. How do you fill the form of this training that seems so abstract? And that's something that, because I'm an actor and I have the experience of going on stage with him, I understand firsthand how to incorporate all the other actor training I've done, you know, which is mostly Stanislavski Bates or Michael Chekhov, or all the other things we learned at Northwestern, the Craig Kinzer's class, for example, all of those things, you know, creating Brechtian fables and all that. I mean, all of that work that I did in undergrad that is, I think, similar to what a lot of actors learn in this country, how then I use that to fill the form that Suzuki gives you and the training gives you, especially in the context of working on production, that helped me a lot in terms of how to create the tone for the book. Thinking that if the actor or the theater artist is reading this, how can they connect with this in a way that's useful, but also stimulates them into new thinking about things. And so they don't get stuck in the same sort of pattern of thought. How can it break open their thinking about not just how to make theater, but how their work, what's the social function of their work as an actor, as an artist? You know, really trying to expand beyond just the technique and the practice. In fact, by being a practitioner, I was able to see the importance of the things in the book that weren't just about practice, that went beyond that, and seeing the value of that. I think, in fact, that's what made it. Being a practitioner made me see the limits of only talking about practice, and to go beyond that.
Maybe one last question. One last question. We will have a little reception afterwards. I hope you will stay a couple of minutes if there are other questions, and if you can, of course. And but maybe one more. Good. So then maybe as a last or short step for me, what are you working on? What are your next projects? You talked a little bit still, maybe about an idea from Meg, but all of you, what are your next things you're onto?
We have so many books.
Oh. So many books, yeah.
So many books in so little time. As Kathy and Emma will attest, like I said before, we have more than we could publish in a lifetime. There's so many writers, and it's just trying to do the best thing for each author that we have.
So who's in the oven? What book are you working on?
Kathy?
Eclipse is coming
out.
Somebody
in the oven. I mean, I can, well, the Leanne Washburn anthology.
There really are a lot of books throughout, you know, various stages of production and everything, but I guess the ones that are closest to coming out are Book of Grace by Susan Laurie Parks. Between Riverside and Crazy just came out. We're working on David Mamet's China Doll, which is at the printer. The first collection of Brandon Jacobs Jenkins. We just published Thomas Bradshaw's first collection. What else are... Oh, Neva by Guillermo Calderon. In a Spanish and English version. Mr. Burns and Other Plays by Anne Washburn.
And our next play in the American Theatre Magazine is?
Dryland, which is coming out in December. But we're also publishing Caught in February by Chris Chen. That's a really exciting.
What's great about Dryland, the interview is going to be with Lucas Nathan's going to interview the playwright for the issue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Lucas, we just published a couple years ago his play, The Christians.
Years ago?
A
year ago. I guess it feels like years ago. Sorry. Time flies. I just tell briefly, I mentioned this science fiction issue, which there's not that many, but we're doing some stories about science fiction plays, which are fun. But in January, our actor training issue, we have an essay by Frances Cowhig, a playwright, who just pitched the idea. She went to the Del Arte International School, and it's a piece about being a playwright doing acting training. And it also inspired me. We're doing a big profile in the same issue about Blanca, Ziska, and Wilma, and about the Antigone she's doing, and then in January she's doing the U.S. premiere of a Tom Stoppard play. It seemed that those two, and this Tom Stoppard play is about the mind-body divide or the mind-body problem. I thought that was the theme. We could talk about mind and body training for actors in a way that they're often too often divided. I think City will figure into the discussion at some point. So we're excited about that.
I'll just add one. We're working with Paula Vogel on expanding her Don Juan Comes Home from Iraq play, and she's developing an anthology of other people's bake-offs on the theme of Don Juan, and it's going to, some of the plays are written by veterans, and it's, I think, going to be an important volume that will be out next year.
I just finished directing Blood Wedding up at Williamstown at Williams College, and now I'm working on a production of The Person of Sichuan and Mowawid's Scorched at the National Universidad de Cuyo in Mendoza, Argentina, which is where I live, actually. And helping that university develop their graduate program.
So wonderful. Actually, Cameron's family is also here. Could you wait a little bit? So thank you for staying up and being awake. You should be very proud of your dad. He is doing really, really great work. And That's right. Hey there. So again, truly, really, thank you for coming. It really means the world to us that you come and be here. We can also only hope that for you it was as meaningful and interesting as it was for me. I really have learned a lot. Thank you again for coming. Hope you come back. And you see the dialogue between the working artist, the practice, the real theater, and writing about it, you know, how important it is to not to lose sight of it. But that's you at the university, whether you're publishing, whether you're running a magazine, investing. This is something that also similar between all of us, and something we all should keep in mind next to the body and mind. So thank you for coming, and hope you stay for a little drink afterwards.
And we'll sign books also.
Yes, we have some books here. For a special prize, or how much?
$15.
$15 instead of 40 or 50, or how much? 100 or whatever it is. So get a book tonight. Thank you.